Good morning, everyone. My name is Melissa. Welcome to Corinth Online. I'm so glad to be worshiping with you all this morning. If you haven't already, we would love for you to go to live.corinth.cc. That's the best platform to watch our online service this morning. During our service today, we're going to do a variety of things. We're going to sing songs together. We're going to take communion together, so now would be a great time to gather up those communion supplies. And then our associate minister, Josh Moore, is going to come on up and preach the second sermon in our series, The All In Life, when we've been talking about how we jump all in with Jesus. And I'm so looking forward to what he has to say for us today. So if you're ready, let's jump into our service.
If you're able, let's stand together as we go into a time of worship.
Good morning. Hey, welcome to Corinth Christian Church. We are really glad that you are here today. If you're in the room, I want to welcome you. And if you are tuning in online, I want to welcome you as well and thank you for joining us. We hope that you have a great experience worshiping with us. And we want to invite you to live.corinth.cc. We think that's the best platform for you to engage with us this morning. So we hope to see you on a new tab right over there. And of course, man, if you're in the room, it's good to see you. If you're visiting us for the first time and you're a guest here at Corinth, we want to say welcome. We are honored that you have taken the time out of your Sunday morning to visit with us. And we want to say thank you by giving you a gift today. And so if that's you, if this is your first time at Corinth, after the service is over, we want to invite you out those double doors and across the hall to our guest services kiosk, where we'll give you a gift just to say thanks for being here. We would also love to connect with you using our connection card. If you grabbed a bulletin on your way in, there's a connection card that looks just like this one in the middle of it. And so we would love for you to fill out that front side of the card as much as you're comfortable sharing with us, and then hand that to the team at the guest services kiosk whenever you go get your gift. But we're really, really glad that you are here. Hey, a few things to let everybody know about as we kind of get into the swing of summer. I don't know if you've realized it or not, but school's up like on Wednesday for Walton County. And so we're excited about that. Summer is here. A couple of things. The first one is VBS. VBS is coming up really quick, and we're really excited about this. We're going to have hundreds of kids here on campus learning about Jesus, worshiping Jesus. And we still need some help with that. So make sure that you visit the VBS table out in the concourse right over there. You can sign up your kids or your grandkids to join us for VBS. You can sign up to volunteer. You can find out what sort of things we still need donated. There are some snacks that can be brought in, all sorts of good things like that. So check out that. And then as well through the summer, we've got all sorts of teen events coming up as well. And so one of them we do is called CIY Move. It's for high school students. We do CIY Mix for middle school students. And for those two events, registration closes on May 31st. So if you plan to be a part of that, you're a teenager, you want to be a part of that, get the info and get signed up today. We also are doing one thing that we've never done before that we're really excited about called the Creative Arts Academy. This is for middle school and high school students. It's going to be a really, really good time as we kind of take a look at worship and arts and all sorts of good things as well. So get signed up for that one too if you're a middle school or high school student. Another thing I want to highlight is something that we talked about in detail last week. It's an event that we're going to do on August 11th and 12th called Feed My Starving Children. And here at Corinth, we're going to be able to, on those 2 days, pack over 100,000 meals and get them sent to kids who are hungry in another part of the world. And so we're really excited. We need 500 volunteers to do this. And last week, we invited you to use the connection card to say, yes, I'm going to serve on August 11th or on August 12th. We want to continue to invite you. If you want to be a part of this, and we encourage you to be a part of it, use the back of your connection card and let us know. We're really excited about the opportunity to be able to do this. Now, the Church Center app is something that if you need more details or you want more details about some of the things that I just mentioned or just in general, the Church Center app is something that you should download and check out. So if you haven't done that, we want to invite you to do that today. Hey, this season at Corinth, just like all seasons at Corinth, because God is so faithful, we've been seeing a lot of decisions, and we want to share a couple more of those decisions with you right now. So check out the screen.
My name is Emily, and I'm here to be baptized. I've been going to church my whole life, and at Winter Blast, I decided to be baptized. During the last night of Winter Blast, there was a really good sermon, and they showed all these videos of people getting baptized, and I just decided that I wanted to get baptized as well. I'm excited because I get to tell people that I'm a Christian, and I get to grow my relationship with God. After I get baptized, I want to be a better person and help more people believe in Jesus. I'd like to thank Tristan and my small group for supporting me and my parents for always being there for me.
Super, super fun that last week I got the honor to marry you and your now wife, Sabrina. And then now this week, man, decision to follow Jesus. I think one of the things that you'll be tempted to think, just because of how incredible last week was that it might be a bigger thing than this. And you know, and I know, and they know it's not.
this right here, even though thousands of dollars didn't get spent on a party, and even though hundreds and hundreds of people didn't come out, what you're doing now is more important than even what you did last week.
I believe
that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept Him.
And I accept Him.
As my Lord.
As my Lord.
And as my Savior.
As my Savior.
Because of that confession you made, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Everybody say all in.
All in.
We love when people make decisions to go all in with Jesus. You see that there. And that's our conversation today as we continue our current sermon series called The All In Life. Josh Moore, our associate minister, is going to preach part number two, and it's about life-changing relationships. Now, one thing I want to ask is, you guys know the connection card that we mention every single Sunday morning. I want to ask, if you grabbed a bulletin, you've got a connection card, you can go ahead and pull that out and keep it close to you throughout our service today. Now, of course, you can always use it to communicate a next step or to submit a prayer request, but today, specifically, Josh is going to highlight some stuff on the back, and we want to encourage you just to be ready, to be prayerful, and to respond today using that connection card. Hey, one more thing before we kind of get on with our service today. Today is May 21st, and we are in the midst of graduation season, and it doesn't take long scrolling Facebook or Instagram to see pictures of high school seniors and college seniors and their caps and gowns, all that good stuff. And man, here at Corinth, we've got a great group of graduating seniors, tons of students from high school and from college, and we always at this time of the year want to honor them and celebrate them. So there's a couple of things to let you know about. We've created a web page called corinth.cc/graduates. And I want to invite you to head over to that web page. And as you look at so many of the names and the faces and the stories of students, would you encourage them by praying for them? So go to corinth.cc/graduates and see all those names and say, man, I pray over their future, their life, their ministry. And man, we'll honor seniors that way. But today, specifically in service, I want to take the opportunity to give it up for seniors and then pray a blessing over them. So if you are a senior who has made it out of bed early enough for the 9:30 service today, I would love to invite you guys to stand so that we can give it up for you and then pray a blessing over you. Are there any seniors in the room? We've got, I know of one because she doesn't want to stand up right there, but let's give it up for this right here, Katie, and then right there in the back as well. Boom. Hey guys, we're really, really proud of you. Really proud of you. And we're like just super hopeful and prayerful about your future. What I'd love to do as we kind of get back into our worship is say a prayer over you. So the whole congregation, if you're not standing, it means you're not a senior, but would you find one of the two that are standing here in service today? Just extend a hand to them and let's pray a blessing over them as we begin to worship again. God, we are grateful for seasons of life and for, just sometimes we're grateful for change. And for the seniors that are here as a part of our congregation, there's some change coming. And we know that you can meet us in the midst of that and call us into deeper relationship with you. So we do pray that that would happen for the seniors here at Corinth, that this transition into life would be a season where they feel your faithfulness and where they pursue you relentlessly. God, we pray that you would bless them, their future, their education, their careers, that you would be close to them always and that they would know it. God, today as we gather as a congregation to proclaim the truth of the gospel, to declare gratitude for your faithfulness, I pray that you would be present and active. And we pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you're able, let's stand again as we go and worship our Father in heaven. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done. Is so big, the world is so big, but God loves us, right? Man, let's worship.
Thank you.
I know that it's pretty unusual to bring a whole library up here, but that's what I've done today. These are all books that are written by Timothy Keller. Timothy Keller is one of my favorite Christian thinkers and teachers and pastors and writers. And if you tune into the podcast quite often, you'll hear one of us reference something that Timothy Keller wrote. And he's just a super, super incredible help. This past week, he ended up passing away. And just really, really want to share with you like some of the things. Like, it seems like for every season of life that I've been in since I picked up my first Tim Keller book in Bible college, there's been something that I've been going through. And so the first one I picked up was for a preaching class in Bible college, and it's just called Preaching. And this book helped me understand how crucial it is to make sure that all of my sermons are gospel and Jesus-centered, always pointing towards Jesus. One of the other ones that I picked up not long after that was a book called Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering. And this book helped me understand that God is good even whenever life is not. Another book that I've picked up of his was one called Counterfeit Gods. This is this one right here. And this book was key for me because it helped me identify where Jesus wasn't first in my life. And I was able to repent because of the words that were in this. And then one of the more recent ones that I picked up before Tristan and I got married was just his book, The Meaning of Marriage, which he wrote alongside of his wife. And this book helped me understand that simply through serving my wife, our marriage can do what it was intended to do, which is reflect the gospel. And certainly there are other books, but man, I'll tell you, I have been blessed by the words of Timothy Keller. And like I said, man, this week he passed away. But earlier this week, before he did, his son posted on social media just an update. And I want to read that to you right now. His son said, "Health update. Today, Dad is being discharged from the hospital to receive hospice care at home. Over the past few days, he has asked us to pray with him often. And he expressed many times through prayer his desire to go home to be with Jesus. His family is very sad because we all wanted more time. But we know he has very little at this point. In prayer, he said 2 nights ago, I'm thankful for all the people who've prayed for me over the years. I'm thankful for my family that loves me. I'm thankful for the time that God has given me. But I'm ready to see Jesus. I can't wait to see Jesus. Send me home." And it's such an incredible perspective, such a grace-filled and hope-filled way to go. And another book that Tim Keller wrote that I have not read that I want to pick up, he wrote a book called On Death. And in that book, here's what he wrote. He said, "All death can do now to a Christian is to make their life infinitely better." And each and every week, man, we take communion. And we do it to celebrate the truth behind that quote that he said, that one death has made our life infinitely better. The death of Jesus on the cross for our sins, so that our sins can be forgiven, so that we can be set free from sin, all that we can experience life with God beyond this earth. 1 Corinthians 15:55 through 57, Paul writes, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law." Verse 57, "But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And for those who have faith in Jesus, man, death is only the beginning. And it leads to life everlasting. And I'm excited to remember the death that does set us free today with communion. I'm going to set this library down and invite you guys to pull out your communion today with me. And we'll look to the cross and we will remember the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, the story of the gospel that gives us hope even in the midst of challenging times. This is Jesus' body broken for us. Let's take and eat together. And then onto the juice, Jesus says, "This is the blood of the new covenant, which was shed and poured out for you." Let's pray together. God, you are good, and we are so grateful for the story of Jesus. We're so grateful that you loved us so much to send him to die on the cross in our place. And we're so grateful that his death eventually led to resurrection. And we're grateful that what that means for us is that when we put our faith in you, ultimately our death leads to life with you. And so we say thank you. Thank you for loving us. We pray in Jesus' name. That song, our prayer, in a very real way. We want to look back and see where you have been faithful in our lives and trust you in this moment today as we open these scriptures, and then look forward to anticipating how you're going to be with us and walk through life with us. We want to see your faithfulness. And oh God, there are people in this room, all of us, just kind of in several different places. Some are really in high spirits right now. Life is good. Others may not know what to do. Others are just straight up discouraged. For all of us, I just pray that we get a glimpse of you and your power that you want to give to us through Jesus and through the community that you want to surround us with. And so, oh God, as we open scriptures, help them to speak to us, to guide us, to correct us, to encourage us. All in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. How you doing today, church? Good. All right. Happy May 21st. School's almost out. It's a good day. I want to start out by just saying thanks, as we always do, for those of you who have chosen to give tithes, offerings, through the mail, here in person, online. The ministry of Corinth just goes on and on. Those baptisms are great to see every week, and we got two more today, so God is good, right? Amen. All right. Hey, if you're watching online, I want to say hi to you today. I'm glad you're with us, and hope to see you next week. I think that'd be a great week to join us. Even though it's Memorial Day weekend, we will be here and ready for you. So, hey, everybody in the room, let's just say hi on the count of three to our friends online. One, two, three.
Hi.
Hi. Howdy. Glad you're with us. Hope you're doing well. And to those of you in the room, I'm super glad to be here with you today. My name's Josh, if you don't know me. One of the ministers here on staff, and excited to jump in, all right? If you don't know, my wife and I got back from a trip 2 weeks ago. We were gone in Israel for about 10 days, just a trip of a lifetime. It was awesome. The Bible, since then, seeing certain places has just come alive. Like, you're imagining how far distances are, or you can see places now, and it's super, super cool. So I thought I'd let you in on it and show you a picture again. And so I wanted to show you a place you've probably heard before, because you maybe have been to a funeral and heard this read, the Valley of the Shadow of Death. You heard that phrase before, Psalm 23. Let's put it up on the screen. All right, this is a real place. Psalm 23, King David writes, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you're with me. Even there, your hand will guide me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." This is the same valley that Jesus would also have referred to in the story of the Good Samaritan. It was a dangerous place. But it's not dangerous because of what you're thinking. Like, you're looking at it going, man, it's a desert. That's like a huge cliff. That's barren. There's rocks. There's hardly any vegetation. How are you going to survive out there? The scorching heat, the arid temperatures, the desert, like, that's not why it's dangerous. You know why it's dangerous? Because it's lonely. See, in Jesus' day, the Romans didn't patrol this road, which meant you had to travel in groups. And if you didn't, you were in danger, because robbers would hide in the cliffs, the natural cliffs in the wall, and they would get unsuspecting travelers. That's why you travel in groups. And it's really a clue for us today that the most dangerous place we can be isn't actually the Valley of the Shadow of Death. We went there and survived. We did great, because we had a bus and we had a group of people that were with us. One time, you know, this guy actually, like, he jumped off a little bit of a ledge, and all the wives were like, but he was just like faking everybody out. It was pretty great. And it wasn't dangerous. We were there together. We knew what to do. The danger is in the isolation. And hear me today. The most dangerous place you can be is isolated. Whether you're at the mall, whether you're at the restaurant, whether you're at your house, or whether you are right here in a crowd of people worshiping Jesus, if you're isolated and alone, the most dangerous place you can be. 1989 was the year that Gallup released a study saying Americans were actually the loneliest people on earth. That's happy news for us, right? Yay. And then 10 years later, there was a book released by Robert Putnam called Bowling Alone that basically just said the same thing. Americans used to bowl in leagues and together, and it was great. And now we just bowl alone. Well, a few years ago, Brené Brown continued to just pile on to the research. And she wrote this book, Atlas of the Heart, Chapter 9, and gives a list of health hazards that you want to avoid if you don't want to die early. So pretty good stuff to listen to, I guess. Air pollution will increase your odds of dying early by 5%. So we got to fix the air. But anyway, there's bigger issues. She said obesity actually will increase your odds of dying early by 20%. Heavy drinking will increase your odds of dying early by 30%. But what tops the list is loneliness at 45%. Increases your odds of dying early, which brings me to the point of today. We need life-changing relationships. We need community, and we need to go all in with that community. See, last week, Adam started this series called All In, and he talked about surrendered living and how the early church really modeled a surrendered life. They were giving their time. They were giving their money. They were sharing their story. They were sharing their service. They went all in. But the early church also went all in with community. And really, the Bible tells that story. Like Genesis chapter 1, the first pages of the Bible, God says, hey, it's not good for you to be alone. And newsflash, that's actually not a wedding ceremony like scripture. That's just like a community scripture. Like, we need each other. Jesus comes to earth, and he spends 3 years with 12 dudes in a small group, and he embodied community. And then he leaves the earth and ascends to heaven, and he leaves the control of his church in the hands of these just ordinary, unschooled people, and they thrive in a big part because of their community. And so once again, just like last week, we're going to turn to the New Testament book of Acts, chapter 2. We're going to look at their example for us, why they were thriving, in part because of the community that they were existing in. And we're just going to maybe take a page from their book and ask, what would it do in our life if we just did what they did? So Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it's a popular verse. Lots of people kind of talk about this as pillars of the early church, and here's what they're doing. Starting in verse 42, I'm going to read. You can follow along on the screen, and it starts like this. Let's say it together. Let's just say the second word. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone. Inside the church, outside the church, they were filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. That's kind of like Luke saying, hey, this is what's going to happen in chapter 3, 4, and 5. Miraculous signs, all kinds of stuff. Here's what else is going to happen. They're going to be together and having everything in common, selling their possessions and goods. They gave to everyone who had need. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes. And they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number, say it with me again, daily. Oh, that was weak. Let's do it again. The Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Man, what a description of the early church thriving in the midst of a culture that sometimes didn't want them to thrive. And how did they do it? Well, they devoted themselves to some pillars. And yes, they had great teaching. They broke bread together in their homes. They prayed together. But what we're talking about today is the all-in-life community that they shared. They were devoted. And here's basically what that word means. They were all in. Like, they were all in with community. Some translations say they continued steadfastly. That's kind of an older way to say it. They continued steadfastly, in part, with the community that they were in. Now, where did they gather with their community? Two places. If you look back at the text, and if you have a Bible open, they gathered first in a place called the temple courts. The temple courts is a public place, and here's why they would go there. It's all evangelistic, because Christianity was born out of Judaism, and these guys, these Christians, they still have, I mean, just think about it, they still have dads and moms, brothers and sisters, cousins, employers, friends, who are Jewish and haven't yet believed in Jesus. And so they're going as a group to the temple courts to share their story about Jesus. Well, they're not just gathering in the temple courts publicly for evangelism. They're gathering privately in homes, house to house, to share meals, to pray together, to experience teaching from the apostles, and they're all doing it in community. The fancy church word is fellowship. The fancy Greek word is koinonia. Have you ever heard that word before? Koinonia. If you've been around church, you might have heard people say koinonia, because people like to say koinonia. Like, even the college campus ministry across town where I went to college, I went to a Bible college, the state university across town. They had a Christian campus fellowship, and they called themselves koinonia. I think they even spelled it in the chain link fence with white styrofoam cups. They wrote koinonia. Come on out, you know. And they wanted to have a strong fellowship. But it's more than just fellowship. Here's the idea behind koinonia. It's not just that you're in the same room with folks, because let's be honest, you can go to a bar and everybody will know your name, right? They made a show about it. Cheers. Okay. Koinonia isn't just being in the same room. It's being on the same mission. And that's what it was that they were devoting themselves to with koinonia fellowship here in Acts chapter 2, and what eventually just took the world by storm. You know, here's kind of the idea behind what they were doing. They were in community, and the idea behind today, I want to give it to you right now, even though it's the bottom line later, but it's so important. I want you to grab this. You can have the community without discipleship. But see, the early church was like following Jesus and chasing him and sharing their story. And so you can't have discipleship without community. Jesus, following Jesus is a team sport. And we do that together. We huddle in community so we can be sent out to share his message. And you can find community somewhere, but you can't follow Jesus without community. Discipleship is impossible without community. And so today, if we want to be all in, the all-in life, and we want to surrender our living, we want to experience life-changing relationships, and we want to make a difference in this world, we've got to have a community. So here's the question. How do we experience life-changing relationships? How do we? Well, Acts chapter 2 said that they devoted themselves to one another, but then the rest of the New Testament kind of gives the behind the scenes of how they were doing that and what they were instructed to do. And raise your hand, have you ever heard the phrase one another in the New Testament? Like you've heard there's one another's of the New Testament. Anybody? Like love one another, be devoted to one another, forgive one another, greet one another with a holy kiss. Anybody do that today? I greeted my wife out before I left the house with a holy kiss. She was still asleep, so I don't know if she remembers that. But there's 59 one another's of the New Testament. And so buckle up. We're going to read a lot of scripture today. Just kidding. We're not going to go through all 59. What I've done is kind of organized two big umbrellas that I want to talk about. If we want life-changing relationships, we need to really be involved in a circle that's going to do two things in our life. If we want to go all in, we need a circle. First of all, who is going to support us? And we need to be all in supporting them. We need to support one another. All right? We need to support one another. You know, Monday nights are our small group night at the Moore House. And I love Monday nights because we get together, and without fail every single week, there are four baskets of unfolded laundry behind the bedroom door. You know, our house isn't perfect, but we gather and we laugh, we eat, and we support one another. You know, recently I was telling them that I was going to go to the airport and had to park and come back. And they're like, don't you do that. Like three people at once spoke up. Don't you park. Don't pay for parking. I'll pick you up. And I love that. Like there was a level of support. Like save me $100 on parking. That was great. You know, there's kinds of support where you're encouraging people nonstop. Like I got this bracelet right here. It's a reminder to me that there's some guys in my life I'm in a circle with that are praying for me on a daily basis. Hebrews 3 says it this way. Encourage one another daily. As long as it's called today, because like the world is tough, like so you won't be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. You need daily encouragement. That's part of support, but you know like there's more. There's a lot more to support than just rides from the airport or daily encouragement. And I want to tell you about one of those in our life. It kind of happened last fall, where we had a heavy situation in our life. The Bible would call it a burden. Galatians 6, chapter 2 says this, carry each other's burdens. And in this way, you fulfill the law of Christ. And so a burden is really where you need support. Because a burden is what you can't carry on your own. A burden is crushing you, and you can't think straight when that news hits you. A burden is a marriage that's just on the brinks. A burden is a child that's like a prodigal running away and you don't know what's happened. A burden is a financial disaster all of a sudden and you don't know how you're going to pay your bills. A burden is going to keep you down unless you have someone else to carry it with you. last October, we had a burden. Many of you know our story as foster parents. We've been in the foster care world for 8 years now. Our son, Dominic, was adopted a year and a half into his journey, and he turned 8 last Thursday. That was so cool, you know, to like celebrate the birthday. We loved that. Luke even gave him a birthday present, a game of tag, and today Dominic sprinted up to Luke and tagged him. It was great. Dominic is wonderful. And our foster care journey has had some high highs like that. We've just seen some really cool things. 5 years ago, we took on another case. And just so you know, the goal of foster care all the time is reunification. It's a fancy word that says we want to reunite, like get back together the biological children with their parents. And absolutely, that's the goal every single time. That's the first goal. And so we were on board with that. Like, we wanted that to happen. They even told us at the beginning, like, don't get attached. This is going really well. And we didn't. You know, we're, like, hopeful and all this stuff. And the months roll on, and it's 6 months. And then it's a year. And we have this placement in our house that now we've taught to walk. Like, we had him since he was 2 days old, and we taught him to walk. And we taught him how to, like, brush his teeth. And he's saying first words. And he has brothers and, like, brother and sisters. And calling us mom and dad, and a year turned into a year and a half, and a year and a half turned into 2 years, and 2 years turned into 3 years. And the trajectory of reunification had changed to adoption. And we were excited about that. We said yes, like we were ready, like, to welcome a child into our home. And then, like, even like DFACS was kind of headed that way. We all assumed that. And I kid you not, there was one court date where it was a 180-degree turn, where all of a sudden, the direction that we had been headed for almost 4 years was changed. And last October was when that reunification ended up happening. And y'all, it's so just wild to talk about. You want to have joy because the family has been reunified, right? But I can't lie to you, like, it's a loss. And it's a change, and it's tough, and we didn't know what to do. We didn't know how we were going to do it. We didn't know what to pray. And that, you know, I don't tell you that story to, like, tug on your heartstrings. I don't tell you that story to actually even look at us at all. I tell you the story so I can once again point to that same circle of people that's given me a ride home from the airport in a few weeks. Because in that moment, they said to my wife and I, like, you get on the floor right now in the middle of the circle on your knees. And that team, I say that on purpose, that team huddled up around us like a team does. They huddle. And what do you do in the huddle? Put your hand in the middle, don't you? And one by one, prayer after prayer after prayer, praying for us to give us strength, because it was a change and it was a loss. And y'all, it's still real 7 months later. I mean, last week was Mother's Day. First time in 5 years. It's a journey. And God is good. And we can still sing to him. But there's still questions. And I need a group to travel with me, and so do you, because you're probably not going to have that happen to you. That was pretty unique and rare to have a case go for 4.5 years before reunification. But you're going to have something. You're going to have a sickness. You're going to have a death. Like, you're going to have an addiction. And somebody's going to be in your life that you have no idea what in the world is going on. You're going to have a betrayal. You're going to have a diagnosis that hits you like a ton of bricks. And if you don't have people to carry your burdens with you, it's too late to get it then. You get in that circle now. Because when that time comes around, you need someone to support you. We support one another in community. Because remember, we're not just in the same room for fellowship. We're on the same mission to chase Jesus with our life and to spread his fame, starting right here in Walton County and to the end of the world. We need a circle to support us And without it, man, we're lost. You can read all the other one another's of scripture this afternoon, all 59 of them, but you're going to see things like weep with those who weep, mourn with those who mourn, and rejoice with those who rejoice. I love one of our other group leaders. He said, that's what it's all about, is having a circle to support you in times like that, because having that circle doesn't diminish the problems. Like, it doesn't make them go away. But it's just better to walk through life with people. And I love what he said. He said, we have had seasons in our life where people that have had incredible joy have wept with those experiencing incredible hardship. Then he said this, 4 years into this small group, strangers have become lifelong friends. I love that picture. We need a circle to support us. We also need a circle to sharpen us. Here's the truth about community. You will be happier and you will be healthier if you get in community. Here's the stats. I love the Journal of Happiness. They talk about happiness all the time, I guess. The Journal of Happiness says that community is a stronger prediction of your happiness than, get this, your career success, your IQ, and even your attractiveness. How about that? So it's better to be ugly in a group of friends than be good looking all by yourself, you know? So join a small group. You'll also be healthier. The stats keep talking about the health of community, because people that like have bad health habits, they are offset by the communities around them. One author even said it this way, it's better to eat a Twinkie in a group of friends than broccoli alone. Like, it really does offset the bad health habits. But you know what? As Christians, we're not just about being happy and healthy. I mean, that's good. And even if you're not ready to follow Jesus yet, like, you should join some community because you'll be happier and healthier. But as Christians, like, there's something more, right? We're following Jesus. We had a mission to carry out. We need to be sharp. And so I love that Proverbs 27:17, it's a famous verse. It's used often for community. It says it this way, as iron sharpens iron, one person sharpens another. And we get in circles and we sharpen one another. So I brought my sharpening tools today. You ready for that? It's not iron. And don't worry, I let our security team know. I got a knife. We're going to be with each other. And each and every week, just a little bit at a time, we're going to rub off some rough edges. We're going to learn some truth from Scripture. We're going to apply it to our life. Here's a one another from the New Testament. Colossians 3:16 says it this way. Let the message of Christ dwell in you richly as you do what? As you teach. As you admonish one another with all wisdom. Man, you got a marriage to cherish, perhaps. You got a wife to take care of. You got a family to lead. We need some people making us sharp. Because when we do this alone, man, we're not the men that we need to be. Wives, mothers, like, you're raising kids, you're working jobs, you're juggling all kinds of stuff. We celebrated you last week because you deserve it. Mother's Day, like, show honor to where honor is due. Like, you're doing incredible work, but you need people to rub shoulders with, to pray together, to encourage you, because it's tough. Each and every one of you have a one in your life. We believe this, that God has put a one in your circle of relationships that you can share your story with, you can share your faith with, invite to Corinth, and disciple Jesus towards Jesus. And unless you're sharp, you may miss those opportunities. So each and every week, as often as we can, we're going to get in circles to sharpen each other so that we are ready for the opportunities that God brings our way. Here's the deal. The mission is too critical for us to just try to do this alone. And what we do when we sharpen one another in a circle it's not just so that we know more. It's so that we do more with what we know, right? I'll say that again. It's not just that we know more. It's so that we do more with what we know, which is why I love that one group said, hey, we're going to like bake 20 casserole meals, put them in the freezer. So when someone has an emergency, someone at Corinth can just go get a freezer meal, take it to the family and say, hey, Corinth Christian Church loves you and this meal has been prepared for you, so you don't have to worry about dinner tonight. That's like doing more with what we know. There was one group that understands middle schoolers' love language is food. Okay, so they said, we're going to provide the meal for middle school ministry Sunday night. We're going to bless them so they can have a different meal other than just pizza. It's good. It's good stuff. And another group, I love this. They called me up. They're like, hey, Josh, you challenged us to like do a service project. So we were thinking, like, would this be okay? They asked me, would this be okay? We thought, like, there's this neighborhood close by. And we could go do a project and like a project forum and pass out Easter invite cards. Is that okay? Like, is that okay? Like, absolutely, that's okay. Like, take your faith and share it because we're on mission, right? We're not just in the same room. We're on the same mission and we sharpen each other. And without those circles, we become dull. Now listen, humor me for just a minute. When you got a knife, and you sharpen it, do you just go put it back in the drawer, leave it? What do you do with it? Come on, what do you do with it? You use it. What do you do? How do you use it? Yeah, you cook stuff. The most dangerous knife is a dull knife. You know that? Pressing real hard, and then you slice your finger open, and it makes a bad cut. So you use it like to prepare a gourmet meal. You share it around the table with your family. It's amazing, right? Humor me for one more second. This is kind of cheesy, but it's okay. It works. Do you know what one knife doesn't say to the other knife? They don't get in the drawer and be like, hey, look how sharp I am. Look how sharp I am, right? I was so sharp. No, they don't do that. The point of us sharpening each other is not so, like, we're sharper than the other person. It's so we carry out the mission together, y'all. We need a circle that supports us. Yes, we need a circle. We need a circle that sharpens us. I mean, big changes will happen in small groups as you circle up with people who are going to do those two things, to support you and to sharpen you. We've been saying it all morning. The bottom line, once again, is just this. You can have community. You can go find it somewhere without discipleship. But if you're following Jesus, you have to have community. There's no way to have discipleship without community. So here's the challenge. Create community. And at the end today, it's going to be just a tad longer than normal. But I'm going to reference this again. Luke said I would. I'm a man of my word. Here's the connection card. I want you to get it out. Because today, it's just a challenge for you to think about some of the circles that you are in or perhaps not in. And here's an opportunity because the back of the connection card says, I'm interested in small groups at Corinth. All right? There's even two boxes on there that says, I'm willing to host or I'm willing to lead. Here's why we put those two boxes. The biggest bottleneck for our group's ministry is not people wanting to get in it. It's people that are willing to host it and to lead it. Because here's the deal. They'll say things like, well, my house isn't big enough. Fair, maybe. But what I always tell people is they're called small groups for a reason. They are small. And so you can have a small group of six. That would be wonderful. Let's do that. You might say, well, I don't know when we would do it. Well, I know when you could do it. Sunday night at 5 to 7 during the school year, we even have childcare here for your groups with children, and it's great. You're like, oh, man, then I have to, like, pack them a lunch and, like, send them a dinner and stuff. No, you wouldn't, because we invest in that as well, and we pay the childcare workers for you. We buy the food for you, so you literally come and drop your kids off for 2 hours, hallelujah, and go circle up with a group of people and pour into one another to support one another and to pray with one another, to sharpen one another, okay? You might be like, well, I don't know if I can teach. It's like, listen, sometimes it's better that you don't know how to teach because then, guess what? Like, God does the work. Remember in Acts 2? Like, he added to their number daily. Like, sometimes when you have the humility of, like, guys, I don't have what it takes. So God's going to do a great work. You just facilitate a space, and that's how it happens. You don't have to know it all. You're like, well, what would I teach? Good question. We got all the curriculum for you. Like, we'll put it in your hands. We'll give you the books. Did you know, I don't know if you knew, but we all have Right Now Media, like it's in your pocket, on your phone, through the Church Center app. You can get it. It's thousands of Bible study resources in your pocket. The point is this, we want to remove every barrier that we can to get you in circles. Here's one more question you got. What if I'm not ready for like a small group where we're studying the scriptures and all that stuff yet? Here's what we want to challenge you with right now. There's a place for you too. And whatever word you want to use, affinity or activity, we want to challenge you to think outside the box a little bit. And this spring and leading into summer, we want to gather people who just want to say, like, maybe I'm willing to explore this option of an activity or an affinity group. And here's what it is. You like to play disc golf, or you like to play ball golf, or you like to, I don't know, play cornhole, or you like to drink coffee early in the morning. You like to go walking while the kids are at school. Get creative and think about what you're already doing and how you can invite a few others along with you. Maybe some people in these rows that don't have a circle yet, or maybe some people that you're just already rubbing shoulders with at work, or you're already at the gym with them, and you can start a circle. Because here's what we want to do. We want to start a lot of circles this fall. We want to start some small groups. We want to start some affinity groups, but we can't do it if people don't host them or if people don't lead them. We need you. Life is better together. And if we're going to chase Jesus, we have to do that in circles. And so we have to get in circles of support, and we have to get in circles of sharpening. And our challenge to you today, to be all in with community, is to create community. If you're not already in one, to jump into one. If you could start one, to start one. Because listen, you give what you have, and that will be enough. You think, I don't have what it takes. You give what you have, and in the hands of God, that is enough. We're looking for people like the prophet Isaiah in the Old Testament. When God said, who am I going to send? Isaiah just goes, well, here I am. I'll go. I'll do it. Let's step up, and you can do that. Man, I'm praying for that to happen today. And if you want to talk more, we can talk more by checking something on a box. Let me be one more disclaimer, and then we'll be done today. One more disclaimer. If you check a box or put something on this card and turn it in, here's what it is not. It is not a commitment right now today to lead something for the rest of your life, and it's going to be amazing. It's just a conversational starter to say, hey, I'm feeling the Spirit of God tug on me because I think I am feeling directed to do this. And we'll start a conversation, and we'll get something happening this fall, hopefully. Disclaimer over. Let's wrap up with this. Community is going to make your life better. Community will make you happier in life. It will make you healthier in life. But I have to end it this way and just say, Jesus, only Jesus can save your life. And if you are not connected to him, we need to start with that as well. And today is a great day. Like every Sunday, we ask, if you have never said yes to Jesus and surrendered and gone all in with him, today you can do that and experience the blessing of baptism. You can submit to him and let him save your life. If you're in the room, once again, the connection card is a great thing to do. Turn it in. Or I'm here after the service and would love to talk to you as well. If you're watching online, there is a website, corinth.cc/decided. Check out that link and follow the form, and we will be in touch this week. Y'all, community, we have to be in a community if we are pursuing Jesus in discipleship. So let's get in the circles that we need to support one another and to sharpen one another in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, we say thank you. We say thank you that you created community, Jesus, that you embodied community, and Spirit, you lived out community in your early church to thrive and literally turn this world upside down. And so today, we ask as your church, 2,000 years later, to really just take a play from their playbook, to be devoted to the fellowship and the gathering, both in the public places and from house to house, as we look to carry out our mission for Jesus. God, life is tough, and we need circles around us. And Lord, the mission is too critical for us to do this alone as well. So we ask for courage to step out into places that are uncomfortable, for wisdom to see what things in life we might need to stop so we can invest in some higher priorities. So God, give us the wisdom to know the decision we need to make and the courage to do that, even if it is difficult, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all, it's been a great day.
Thank you so much for joining us online this morning. We hope that you enjoyed our service. If you're wanting to know more about our church, I encourage you to go to our church website, corinth.cc. You can find out all kinds of information about upcoming events, weekly programs we have going on. Pretty much any question you have about our church, you can find the answer there. And we hope to see you in person sometime soon. Have a great week.